Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I'm grateful to Professor Cosseno and to representatives of UNESCO that I can open our conference here. I think this also is a recognition of the long-standing relations between Germany and Russia in philosophy, with mutual learning for one another. Now, I'm sorry I think that I will start now the academic business in the more liberal sense. I agreed, the organizers and I agreed to change the topic. I am talking about the internal relationship between human dignity and human rights. That seems to be trivial, but as I will explain, it's not just a trivial fact. Article 1, as you know, of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights begins with the statement, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. And the same in our German Constitution. Human dignity features prominently in human rights discourse and in juridical decision making today. Let me first start with an example from my home country. The inviolability of human dignity commanded the attention of the German public in 2006, when the Federal Constitutional Court declared the so-called Aviation Security Act to be unconstitutional. When it was enacted, the Parliament had in mind the 9/11 scenario, the terrorist attack on the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center, and the intention of the bill was to authorize our armed forces in such a situation to shoot down a passenger aircraft which had been transformed into a living missile in order to avert the threat to an indeterminately large number of people on the ground. However, the court took the view that the killing of passengers by agencies of the state under such circumstances would be unconstitutional. It argued that the duty of the state to protect the lives of the potential victims of a terrorist attack is secondary to the duty to respect the human dignity of the passengers. I quote, with their lives being disposed of unilaterally by the state, the persons on board the aircraft are denied the value which is due to human being for his or her own sake. The echo of Kant's categorical imperative is unmistakable in these words of the court. The respect for the dignity of every person forbids the state to dispose of any individual merely as a means to another end, even if that end be to save the lives of many other people. It is an interesting fact, however, that it was only after the Second World War that the philosophical concept of human dignity, which already existed in antiquity and acquired its firm canonical expression in Kant, found its way into texts of international law and recent national constitutions. The notion of human dignity featured as a legal concept neither in the classical human rights declarations of the 18th century nor in the codifications of the 19th century. We face the question then, why does talk of human rights feature so much earlier in the law than that of human dignity? Is it only against the historical background of the mass crimes of World War II and the Holocaust that the idea of human rights becomes, so to say, morally charged and possibly overcharged with the concept of human dignity? The rather recent career of the concept of human dignity in constitutional and international law tends to support this idea of a contextual charging of human rights from inside, from outside. Anyway, the temporal dislocation between the history of human rights dating back to the 17th century and the relatively recent currency of the concept of human dignity in national and international law remains a striking fact. Contrary to the assumption of a retrospective moral charging of human rights, I would like to defend the thesis that an intimate, if initially only implicit, conceptual connection has existed from the very beginning. Our intuition tells us that human rights have always been the product of resistance to despotism, oppression, and humiliation. Today, no one can utter, for example, the proposition, no one shall be subjected to torture or to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment or punishment, without hearing the echo of the outcry of countless tortured and murdered human creatures. The appeal to human rights feeds off the outrage of the humiliated and the violation of their human dignity. Now, if this falls, as I am going to argue, if this falls, the historical starting point, traces of a conceptual connection between human dignity and human rights should be evident from early on. How will I proceed? I will first present some legal reasons in support of the claim that human dignity is not only an empty placeholder which lumps a multiplicity of different phenomena together, but a moral source from which all of the basic rights derive their sustenance. I will then, secondly, present, in terms of a conceptual history, an analysis of the catalytic role played by the concept of human dignity in the construction of human rights, and finally, it is that origin of human rights and the moral notion of human dignity which explains the explosive political force of the contemporary human rights politics. First to the legal aspects. Because of their abstract character, every right civil rights in general need to be spelled out in concrete terms in each particular case. In the process, lawmakers and judges often arrive at different results in different cultural contexts, of course. Today, this is apparent, for example, in the regulation of controversial ethical issues such as assisted suicide, abortion, or genetic enhancement. It is also uncontroversial that universal legal concepts facilitate negotiated compromises. Thus, appealing to the concept of human dignity undoubtedly made it easier to reach an overlapping consensus, for example, during the foundation of the United Nations. Everyone could agree that human dignity was central, but not why or how. The fact that the concept of human dignity can also occasionally facilitate compromises cannot, however, explain its belated emergence as a legal concept. I would like to argue that changing historical conditions have merely made us aware of something that was inscribed in human rights implicitly from the outset. Thus, judges appeal to the protection, for instance, of human dignity when the unforeseeable risks of new invasive technologies lead them to introduce a new right, for example, a right to informational self-determination. The experience of the violation of human dignity has performed and can still perform an inventive function in many cases, be it in view of the unbearable social conditions and the marginalization of impoverished social classes, or in view of the unequal treatment of women and men at the workplace, and of discrimination against foreigners and against cultural, linguistic, religious, and racial minorities, or finally, in view of the brutal expulsion of illegal immigrants and asylum seekers. In the light of such specific challenges, different aspects of the meaning of human dignity emerges from the plethora of experiences of what it means to get humiliated or deeply hurt. The specific features of human dignity actualized in one or the other way can then lead both to a more complete exhaustion of existing civil rights and to the discovery and construction of new ones. Through this process, the background intuition of humiliation forces its way into the consciousness of suffering individuals and then into the legal context where it finds conceptual articulation and elaboration. This discovery function of human dignity is then also the key to the logical interconnection between those different categories of human rights as we know them today. The liberal rights, which crystallize around the inviolability and security of the individual person, around free commerce, and around the unhindered exercise of religion, are designed to prevent the intrusion of the state into the private sphere. They constitute, together with the political rights of communication, association, and voting, the packages of so-called classical civil rights. In fact, however, the citizens have equal opportunities to make use of these rights only when they simultaneously enjoy guarantees of a sufficient level of independence in their private and economic lives, and when they are able to form their personal identities in the cultural environment of their choice. Classical civil rights acquire equal value, you remember, once, for all citizens only when they are supplemented by social and cultural rights. The claims to the former share in the prosperity and culture of society are directed against yawning social inequalities and against the exclusion of whole groups from the life of society and culture. Thus, policies which pretend to be able to secure an autonomous life for citizens primarily through guarantees of economic liberties tend to destroy the balance between the different categories of basic rights as much as the repression of free speech, effective political participation, and access to independent and impartial courts. Very important in this country, as I read in our newspapers. Human dignity, which is one and the same everywhere, and for everyone, grounds the indivisibility of all categories of human rights. Human dignities form, so to say, the entrance, the portal through which the egalitarian and universalistic substance of morality is imported into law. The idea of human dignity is the conceptual hinge, the bridge, which connects the morality of equal respect for everyone with positive law and democratic lawmaking in such a way that their interplay could give rise to a political order founded upon human rights. Because now the moral promise of equal respect for everybody is supposed to be cashed out in legal currency, human rights exhibit a generous face turned simultaneously to morality and law. They are designed to be spelled out in concrete terms through democratic legislation, to be specified from case to case in adjudication, and to be enforced in cases of violation. Thus, human rights certify precisely that and only that part of morality which can be translated into the medium of coercive law and become political reality in the robust shape of effective civil rights. In this entirely new category of rights, known since the late 18th century, two elements are reunited that had first become separated in the course of the disintegration, at least in the West, of Christian natural law, and then developed in opposite directions. The result of this differentiation was, on the one side, the internalized, rationally justified morality anchored in the individual conscience, which in turn withdraws entirely into the transcendental domain, And on the other side, the commercial, positive, elective law, which serves absolutist rulers or assemblies of these states as an instrument for constructing the institutions of the modern state and a market society. I'm talking about early modernity in the West. The concept of human rights is a product of an improbable synthesis of these two elements. And what is important in our context, human dignity serves as a conceptual hinge in establishing this connection. This leads me now in the second part of my brief considerations to cast a brief look back on conceptual history, in the course of which the old Roman and Christian concepts of human dignity were transformed in the process of this modern synthesis. In this amalgamation, there operates one further conceptual element, the notion of social dignity in the sense of an honor that has become associated with particular statuses in the stratified societies of medieval and early modern Europe. Here I would like to highlight just two aspects. On the one hand, the mediating function of human dignity in the shift of perspective from moral duties to legal claims, and on the other hand, the paradoxical generalization of a concept of dignity that was originally geared not to any distribution of dignity, but to status differences. The modern doctrines of morality and law, which claim to rest on human reason alone, share the concepts of individual autonomy and equal respect for everyone. This common foundation of morality and law often obscures the decisive difference that whereas morality imposes duties that pervade all spheres of life, modern law creates well-defined domains of private choice for the pursuit of an individual life of one's own. Under the revolutionary premise that everything is permitted which is not explicitly prohibited, subjective rights in the legal sense, rather than duties, constitute the starting point for the construction of modern legal systems. The guiding principle for Hobbes and for modern law generally is that all persons are allowed to act or to refrain from acting as they wish within the confines of the law. Actors thus take a different perspective when, instead of following moral commands, they make use of their rights. A person in a moral relation asks themselves what she owes to another person, whereas people who stand in a legal relation are concerned about potential claims they raise against other persons. To put it in a nutshell, the transition from morality to law calls, which we make all day, this tradition back and forth calls for a shift from symmetrically intertwined perspectives of respect and esteem for the autonomy of the other to, now in law, raising claims to recognition for one's own autonomy by the other. The morally enjoined concern for the vulnerable other is replaced and more by the self-confident demand for legal recognition of a self-determined subject. Thus, the legal recognition claimed by citizens for themselves reaches beyond the reciprocal moral recognition of responsible subjects. It has the concrete meaning of the respect demanded for a status that the legal subject deserves, and as such, legal recognition is infused with the connotations of the dignity which once was associated with membership in a socially respected cooperative body. The concrete concept of dignity or of social honor belongs to the world of hierarchically ordered traditional societies. In those societies, a person could derive his dignity and self-respect, for example, from the code of honor of the nobility, from the efforts of trade guilds and professions, or, in our case, from the cooperative spirit of universities. When these status-dependent dignities, which occur in the plural, now coalesce into the universal dignity of human beings, this new abstract dignity sheds the particular characteristics of a cooperative ethos. At the same time, however, the universalized dignity, which accrues to all persons equally, preserves the connotation of a self-respect which depends on social recognition. As such a form of social dignity, human dignity also requires anchoring in a social status. That is, membership in an organized community in space and time. But in this case, the status must be an equal one for everyone. Thus, the concept of human dignity transfers the content of a morality of equal respect for everyone to the status order of citizens who derive their self-respect from the fact that they are entitled to recognition for all the other citizens as subjects of equal rights. Yet one question is still open. How can we understand that process of melding particular social dignities together in the shape of universal human dignity, both conceptually and historically? Jeremy Baldwin, the colleague of ours, draws attention to the paradoxical fact that the egalitarian concept of human dignity is the result of a generalization of particularistic dignities which must not lose the connotation of fine distinctions entirely. I quote him, once associated with hierarchical differentiation of rank and status, dignity now conveys the idea that all human persons belong to the same rank, and that the rank is a very high one indeed. Walden understands the generalization in such a way that all citizens now acquire the highest rank possible, for example, which was reserved for the nobility. But message captured the meaning of the equal dignity of every human being. Even the direct precursors of the concept of human dignity in the philosophy of the Stoics and in Roman humanism do not form a semantic bridge to the egalitarian meaning of the modern concept. That developed a, classic period, developed a collective notion of dignitas humana, but it was explained in terms of a distinguished ontological status of human beings in the cosmos, of the particular rank enjoyed by human beings vis-à-vis lower forms of life. The superior value of the species now might have justified some kind of species protection, but not the inviolability of the dignity of the individual person as a source of normative things. Two decisive stages in the genealogy of the concept are still missing. First, the generalizing attribution of dignity to the human species must be followed by individualization. The issue is the birth of the individual in the horizontal relation between different human beings, not the status of human beings in the vertical relation to God or to the lower creatures on the evolutionary scale. Second, the relative superiority of humanity and its members must be replaced by the absolute worth of any person. The issue of the unique worth of each person. These two steps were taken in Europe when ideas from the Judeo-Christian and also the Islamic tradition were appropriated by philosophy. A close connection was already drawn between dignitas and let me skip some of the details of my conceptual history. I know you are tired, and these were the two decisive steps, a history in which, for instance, Spanish scholasticism was playing a certain role when subjective rights became differentiated from the objective natural order of rights, or, of course, Pufendorf and Kant played a role. My point is that dignitas is the conceptual hinge between, so to say, the universalist potential of morality and the legal medium in which it can only become effective if it is institutionalized in terms of human rights as a basis of democratic citizenship. That means, again, as a basis for a membership within, in this case, a political community. Now, this excursion into the conceptual history was to explain only this, what I just said. The moral, let me just add one more thought. The moral charging of coercive rights explains why the foundation of Frank's individual states at the end of the 18th century gave rise to a provocative tension, almost a clash across modern societies in general, at least today. Of course, in social space, there exists a difference between norms and actual behavior everywhere. However, the unprecedented event of a constitution-making practice, which institutionalizing human rights, gave rise to an entirely different, almost utopian gap in the dimension of historical time. On the one hand, human rights could acquire the quality of enforceable rights only within a particular political community, that is, within a nation state. On the other hand, human rights are connected with a universalistic claim to validity which points beyond all national boundaries. This contradiction would and could find a reasonable solution only in a constitutionalized world society, not necessarily with the characteristics of a world republic. This is, of course, a different topic. From the outset, a dialectical tension now has existed between human rights and the established civil rights, between droit de l'homme and droit des citoyens. Under favorable historical conditions, that tension between exclusion and inclusion triggers a mutually reinforcing dynamic. This is not to suggest a self-fulfilling dynamic. Increasing the protection of human rights within our nation states, or pushing the global spread of human rights beyond national boundaries, has never been possible without social movements and political struggles, without courageous resistance to oppression and degradation. The struggle to implement human rights continues today in our Western countries as well as in Iran and China, in parts of Africa and Africa, and of course in Russia too. The first human rights declaration set a standard which inspires refugees, people who have been thrust into misery, and those who have been ostracized and illuminated, a standard which can give them the assurance that their suffering is not a natural destiny. The translation of the first human right into positive law gave rights to a legal duty, to realize exacting moral requirements effectively, and that has become engraved, I think, into the collective memory of humanity and morality.